it's a real honor and a pleasure for us to have Dan here. Dan is a philosopher of mind, a cognitive scientist, a philosopher of science, who has made huge contributions to debates in all these areas. So it really is a delight to have Dan with us, and I'm going to hand you over to him right now. Dan, thanks very much.
Thank you very much. Did a very good job of selling me on the virtues of the place, and it's really the sort of thing that I'm used to in the States, and I think it's high time that Great Britain had a school like this, and I'm delighted to be in on the beginning of it. And much has been written, much ink has been spilled on how there's this great gap between the natural sciences and, well, let's face it, Geisteswissenschaft, you might translate as soul science. Or you might translate it as humanities. We are now sitting in Das Neues Geisteswissenschaftskollegium. Sounds deeper somehow in German, and somehow more turgid. How many of you have encountered the distinction between Naturwissenschaft and Geisteswissenschaft? Some people make very heavy weather of that. Well, I'm here to say, forget it. There is no great divide. There is a big difference between the natural sciences and the social sciences and humanities, but it's not that big. And in fact, in the 21st century, if you don't have the humanities very comfortably and happily anchored and ensconced in the natural sciences, you're going to be making a big mistake. It's time to stop trying to keep the natural sciences out of the humanities, because when they come in, they actually help. And all the things that you want to do in the humanities and the social sciences, you can do better, if you have the humanities nicely grounded in the physical world that the physical sciences, the natural sciences, deal with. Now, I don't know how many of you are already thinking, oh heck, you really like the isolation, you like to think of the humanities as a world apart, as not that grubby natural science stuff. Well, if that's your view, then I'm here to cajole you out of your fantasy and show you how the humanities, the real proper humanities, are better understood once you see how we got there. That's what this is going to be all about. The weird thing about this as a hot button issue is that both sides get all anxious and excited and upset about this. There are a lot of people who, if you say anything about how humans are different from other animals, they jump all over you and say, no, we're just animals, we're mammals. This awful human exceptionalism. And there are just as many people, maybe more, who, if you say we're just animals, say, oh no, you're one of those awful reductionist scientistic people, we're not just animals. Well, which is it? Well, of course, it's a bit of both. We don't have a field of simianities, as far as I know, or dolphinities, or caminities. We do have the field of humanities. Right there already tells you what's different about Homo sapiens as a species. We have the humanities. No other genus or family or clade has the humanities, just us. There's no chimp humanities or simianities, there's just the humanities. And that's what you're studying, that's why you're here. So now the question is, how did the humanities come to arrive? Because, think about it, 200,000 years ago there were no humanities. There were physiological modern Homo sapiens, but there wasn't no humanities yet. We go back 6 million years to the common ancestor with the chimpanzee and the bonobo. Our ancestors back then were very much like chimpanzees and bonobos. We are, as Jared Diamond memorably puts it, we're the third chimpanzee. Very closely related. Something happened over the 6 million years from when we parted company from our chimpanzee-like ancestors. And remember, it's always important to remember, chimpanzees and bonobos have been evolving away from that common ancestor just as long as we have. If you think we evolved from chimpanzees, that is as wrong as saying that chimpanzees evolved from human beings. Chimpanzees and bonobos and human beings all evolved from a common ancestor. It was an ape. And it was certainly much more like a chimpanzee than like a human being. But it wasn't a chimpanzee. And it wasn't a human being. So we are just animals, but we're very different from all other animals. And that's what we want to talk about. How did we get that way? The late Paul McCready, one of my favorite thinkers, an engineer, but a very humanistic and green engineer. You may know him for the Gossamer Albatross. Who knows what the Gossamer Albatross was? That was the human-powered pedaled plane that flew across the English Channel. The dream of Icarus. Brilliant bit of engineering. Well, Paul McCready had ideas, great ideas, on all sorts of topics, and I want to talk about one of his ideas, less well known, that I call the McCready explosion. Let's go back 10,000 years. Not 6 million, but 10,000. This is at the dawn of agriculture. Some human beings, not that many at the time, they'd already started domesticating animals, so they had some livestock, they had some pets, they had some dogs. Maybe they didn't have dogs yet, but this was around that time. Anyway, 10,000 years ago, at the dawn of agriculture, McCready calculates that the human population alive on the planet at the time, plus their livestock and pets, was less than, it was about 0.1% of the terrestrial vertebrate biomass. That's the animals. Doesn't include the insects, doesn't include the worms, doesn't include the fish in the sea. But what we normally think of as animals. Reptiles, birds, mammals, etc. The animals. Vertebrate, terrestrial biomass. So it's that was only 10,000 years ago, prehistory, but only 10,000 years ago. And it was less than 1%. What do you suppose the percentage is today?
30. No, that's 10%.
10?
More.
Less. Do I hear any advance on 30?
If you say biomass, do you also count like trees and stuff?
No.
Only
the vertebrate biomass.
Or then like...
Of the terrestrial vertebrate. You put the elephants and the crocodiles and the gorillas and the aurochs and the antelopes on one side of the scale and all the monkeys and so forth, and you put human beings and their cattle and their dogs if they had it on the other side of the scale, and human beings are less than 1%. And what is it today? Do I hear any advance on 30%? 90%. You're low. It's 98%. What? Yes, we have swamped the planet in 10,000 years. Most of that is cattle. Thank you, Big Mac. Cattle, sheep, pigs, horses, domesticated animals, they outweigh the human population, but not by all that much. We now have 7 billion people. And we are now 98% of the terrestrial vertebrate biomass, and that's in only 10,000 years, which is just a twinkling of an eye in evolutionary time. Just a twinkling of an eye. Human beings, the human beings back then, were basically genetically as close to identical to us as they could be. You know, shave them and shower them and dress them up, and they would be indistinguishable from anybody else in London. Even in the hospital, tests would be hard to tell. They were fully modern human beings. That was only 10,000 years ago, and look what they've done in the last 10,000 years. They've changed the planet like no species has ever changed the planet before. McCready has this to say about it. He says, over billions of years, on a unique sphere, chance has painted a thin covering of life, complex, improbable, wonderful, and fragile. I love this image of a thin coat of paint. That's all life is on this planet. It doesn't go very deep. Does it go a mile deep? Yeah, it's more than a mile deep. It goes 5 miles deep? Yeah, it doesn't go any deeper than that. A thin coat of paint. Complex, improbable, wonderful, fragile. He goes on to say, suddenly we humans have grown in population, technology, and intelligence to a position of terrible power. We now wield the paintbrush. And I highlighted technology and intelligence because, as McCready suggests, they are the key. Look what Freeman Dyson, Nobel laureate physicist, has to say. Technology is a gift of God. After the gift of life, it is perhaps the greatest of God's gift. It is the mother of civilizations, of arts, and of sciences. I might add, he also is a winner of the Templeton Prize. I won't say more about that. So he's a physicist, mathematician, and a religious man. But forget about the religious side of it. He's here singing the praises of technology as a great gift, and it is. And as he mentions, the arts and the sciences, in other words, the arts and the humanities and the sciences. The humanities depend primarily on the technologies of representation. Speaking, which has existed more than 10,000 years, but it's not clear when speaking first came on the scene. Some people think fairly recently as 100,000 years for full language. Some people think it goes back a million years. But that's still 1 out of 6 million years since our split with the chimpanzee. Speaking is language, even oral language, is quite recent. Writing is, of course, more recent still. Maybe 5,000 years old, if you count some of the early systems. Counting and calculating, and of course, money. It's important to realize these are, in a sense, technologies. No other animal has them. They're human artifacts. And think of how much they enable in the world. They enable the new college of the humanities, for sure. Without any of these, it wouldn't exist. And also drawing, not just pictures, but architectural diagrams and diagrams of all kinds, and maps of the world. Musical notation. We take all of this for granted, and yet these are all innovations that had to arise, they had to be devised, they are brilliantly designed to do what they're good at. And now the question is, where did that design come from? Did it come from God? No. Was it dreamt up by really clever people? No. This is the most startling thing I'm going to be talking to you about. I'm going to be arguing that, like almost everything else in the biosphere, we want to look at this gradually, as a gradualistic process, and we want to be on the lookout for what I call a strange inversion. And the particular strange inversion I'm going to be highlighting here is that it's not that really smart people designed these things, but that these things got brilliantly designed by an evolutionary process that made us smarter. The intelligence is a product of, an effect of the things, not the source of. More on that. Not a gift from God, what? And how? That's really what I'm talking about. Technology, in that very broad sense, which includes all of the thinking tools of the humanities and the social sciences, starting with oral language and continuing through that list. How did it arrive on the scene? That's what I'm talking about. So I'm going to give the four lectures. The first one is an overview of the problems. That's this one. Then I'm going to talk about early days of human culture, and I'm going to talk about the role of memes. How many of you know what memes are? Well, okay, the rest of you will soon learn. Then I'm going to be talking about minds, human minds, as virtual machines running on brains. You have a smartphone? I was talking with a designer of apps for the iPhone not recently, and he said that some of the apps that he's working on, he counted about 10 layers. Virtual machines implemented on virtual machines implemented on virtual machines. If you don't know what a virtual machine is, then that's fine, because I'm going to teach you, because it's a concept that every humanist should have in his kit, or her kit. If you want to understand how a human mind works, if you want to understand how the virtual machines that run on the brain do their work, and where they came from. Then, having built that foundation, then in the fourth lecture, I'm going to talk about how we go from the Darwinian process of evolution to intelligent design. We circle around, and we're right back to where some people think we start. So that's the trip we're going to make here. So now I'm going to talk about overview of the problem so you can see better where we're going. And this is a book which I highly recommend if you've got any taste at all for science. It's one of the great books on evolution written in the last 100 years by the late, great John Maynard Smith and Ersch Zatbari. He's one of those Hungarians that is so famously clever. They say about Hungarians that, you know, they enter the revolving door after you and come out ahead of you. They are famously ingenious and clever, and Ersch is one of the most ingenious and clever that's working these days. And the two of them together wrote an amazing book called The Major Transitions in Evolution. It's tough reading, but it's very well written. You can read it. How many of you have read Darwin's Origin of Species? It's wonderful, wonderfully written. It's great reading. It's a page turner. It's stylish. It's a great read. If you haven't read it, I'd say try it. You'll love it. It's really gripping and exciting. And he's a wonderful, modest writer, and he builds the case so clearly and carefully. Highly recommended. This is a more difficult book by a wide margin. There's even some math in it. But it's brilliant. And what these folks are pointing out is that evolution isn't just a one-time-all process. Over the history of evolution, how long has evolution been going? Anybody know on this planet?
6 million years.
No, that's just evolution since the chimpanzee. This is Johnny come lately.
It's going to be 4.5 billion.
4.5 billion is the age of, pretty much the age of the planet. And 3.5 billion, the first life that we know of for sure, are some bacteria that Bill Knopf discovered in Australia. And they're about 3.6 billion years old. So we got 3.5 billion years of life on the planet. So that's how long evolution has been going. And during that time, it started slow and simple, and very slow, grinding along, and then it picked up speed, at various points. There were major transitions, sort of like a gear shift. You start low, grind along for a while, 1.5 billion years, then you shift into second, now you go faster for 100 million years or more, and so forth. And here are a few of their major transitions. The eukaryotic revolution, I'll say more about that in a minute. Sex, you'd be happy to know that sex is a major transition. In what sense? Well, before there was sex, there was asexual reproduction, like bacteria, like amoebas. They just split, mother and daughter, and no sex, and basically self-cloning. Turns out, simple as that is, it's not the best way. Sexual reproduction actually speeds up evolution. That's not why it happened. But once it came on the scene, it speeds up evolution by permitting the exploration of more parts of design space by a given population. They get to try out more combinations. They can share the wealth. And that turns out to speed up evolution. It's a long story, and since this isn't a philosophy of biology course, I'm not going to say more. Probably that's the last time I'll mention sex. Sorry. Wouldn't be sexy sex anyway, so. Multicellularity, one of the great transitions. Think about it. To a first approximation, everything that's alive that you can see is multicellular. You can't see with the naked eye. Well, yeah, you can see an amoeba. I take that back. You can see some amoebas are big enough so you can see them with the naked eye, but you really should look at them under the microscope. Multicellularity. Oh, and by the way, every now and then I'll just feed you a little amazing fact. Here's one. Bacteria, another single-celled creatures. There's many more of them and many more varieties of them than we used to think. Just in the last 20 years, we've discovered a whole lot of new unicellular life forms. How much? Well, most calculations are that they actually, by weight, they outweigh the rest of the life that we knew about 25 years ago. That is, if you take everything that has been taxonomized since Linnaeus, all the plants, all the animals, all the germs, all the bugs and the insects and the worms and the plants, take them all, put them on the scale, and on the other scale, side of the scale, you put varieties of unicellular life form that we did not imagine existed 20 years ago, and the newcomers would outweigh the others. There's that much more life than we ever dreamt of in the oceans and so on. Then, language and human culture. Zach Murray and Maynard Smith add these as major transitions. Well, we've seen why the MacCready explosion was due to these. So it certainly changed the planet in a major way and sped up evolution. So that's what we're mainly going to be talking about. They go together. But before I go to them, I want to go back and talk about the eukaryotic revolution, because I want to make a parallel. You read time, it's easier if I just sort of stand over here, I guess. Here's the birth of the Earth 4 billion some years ago. Life starts pretty early. It starts as single-celled organisms. They come in two varieties, so-called bacteria and so-called archaea. And if any of you are classicists, you realize that that means beginners or archaic forms. We've only had the category of archaea for, 30 years. Since Woese discovered them and made it clear to everybody. Now, there's a great debate over whether archaea or bacteria came first. And that's not settled. We don't need to worry about it. The main thing is the eukaryotes. Everything that isn't a bacterium or an archaeum, is a eukaryote. We're eukaryotes, salmon are eukaryotes, pine trees are eukaryotes, rabbits are eukaryotes, worms are eukaryotes. Basically, all multicellular life forms are eukaryotes, but there's also a lot of single-celled eukaryotes, too. Amoebas are a good example. And I want to explain to you, this is more biology than you counted on, perhaps, but it's important. I want to explain to you how the eukaryotic revolution occurred. And you can see it right here. Look at the fan-out of life. All of these varieties, plants, algae, fungi, sponges, corals, worms, spiders, insects, crustaceans, mollusks, echinoderms, sharks, fish, lungfish, amphibians, reptiles, birds, and mammals, all of them evolved thanks to the eukaryotic revolution, which was one of the great transitions. And what happened? Here's what happened. One day, right about 2 billion years ago, there were two, let's call them bacteria, two different bacteria floating around, just the way bacteria do, floating around. And every now and then they bump into each other, you know, as bacteria might do. Now usually when two such entities bump into each other, one of them eats the other. Either by engulfing it and then disassembling the parts and using them and then spewing out the parts it can use, that's eating. Or sometimes the one that's engulfed is actually invading and it eats the other one from the inside out, using the parts as it goes. Okay, so that's normally when two prokaryotes, which is the generic name for either a bacterium or an archaea, whenever two prokaryotes come together, normally it's death for one of them to the advantage of the other, if they don't just bounce off. But one time, and it only had to happen once, something different happened. A and B came along and boom! B engulfed A and didn't take it apart. Instead, joined forces. And you had a new thing, an AB thing, which had all the competences of A plus all the competences of B. Technology transfer. Boom. You put together, you know, the cell phone and the jet plane, and you get something new. It turns out that this pioneer symbiosis, living together, was fitter in the evolutionary sense than either A or B by itself. In other words, by joining forces, it did better. And so it had offspring that shared their fate too, that were ABs, not either A's or B's. And they spread, and they spread, and they prospered, and those are the eukaryotes. That is now known about as well as any biology is. It was controversial for many years. Lynn Margulis, who died just last year, a good friend of mine, was the woman who really made her reputation and nearly destroyed her reputation by championing this idea, and she was hooted at for years, and then finally, it's in all the textbooks now. She was right. She was right in a big way. A real hero of science, Lynn Margulis. And the fossil traces of this original endosymbiotic, endo means inside, symbiosis means symbiosis, you know about symbiosis. This is called the endosymbiotic origin of eukaryotes. And here is the evidence that it really happened. Every cell, every human cell in your body is a direct descendant of that original endosymbiotic event, and it has the fossil traces inside it. Because every cell in your body, since it is a eukaryotic cell, has two genomes. The descendants of the B genome and the descendants of the A genome. The B genome, that's your nuclear DNA. The A genome, that's your mitochondrial DNA. Now, you only get your mitochondria from your mother. Sperm cells have the mitochondria stripped off. So, whether you're a man or a woman, you've got your mitochondrial DNA from your mother, who got it from her mother, who got it from her mother, and it goes back and back and back and back and back to a common source, like the common source, like the common ancestor of the chimpanzee and the human being. This is a much more recent common ancestor of all human beings alive on the planet today, and she's known as mitochondrial Eve. Her mitochondria are in your body, and your body, and your body, and Anthony's body, and my body, in the body of every person alive on the globe. Then we have our own genomes. You know, the genome that gets sequenced, that's a different genome. You can sequence the mitochondrial genome too. In fact, a lot of good research is done on that. The MacCready explosion is an explosive amplification of competence, same as the eukaryotic revolution was. You bring together things and suddenly you have a much more competent entity, an enculturated entity of a certain sort. And initially, it's competence without comprehension. If I were to make a bumper sticker, this would be a competence without comprehension. I want you to understand that concept, because it's a deeply counterintuitive concept. Once you understand it, you'll see it everywhere and you appreciate this is one of the mainsprings of life and of culture. Competence without comprehension, which evolves into competence with comprehension. That's what we want to understand. I like to say this is the Darwinian strange inversion reinverted. So now you have to understand what a strange inversion is. You're all familiar with this picture. This is the pre-Darwinian worldview. God, the artificer, the intelligent designer, is putting the finishing touches on Adam, his magnificent creation. This is, if you like, the trickle-down theory of intelligent design. Takes a big, fancy, intelligent, brilliant, foresighted mind to make a somewhat lesser entity, a human being, made in God's image, but, you know, not a God. That's the pre-Darwinian vision. And here's the Darwinian inversion. I love to read this passage by an Englishman named Mackenzie, writing 10 years after Darwin's Origin hit the world. And this is really wonderful. By the way, the caps were in the original. In the theory with which we have to deal, absolute ignorance is the artificer, so that we may enunciate as the fundamental principle of the whole system that in order to make a perfect and beautiful machine, it is not requisite to know how to make it. This proposition will be found, on careful examination, to express in condensed form the essential purport of the theory, and to express in a few words all Mr. Darwin's meaning, who, by a strange inversion of reasoning, seems to think absolute ignorance fully qualified to take the place of absolute wisdom in all the achievements of creative skill. Bingo, he's right. That's exactly what Darwin was doing. Exactly. And it is a strange inversion of reasoning. It's too strange for many of our fellow citizens. This is a bit of propaganda from a creationist. Do you know of any building that didn't have a builder? Yes, no. Do you know of any painting that didn't have a painter? Do you know of any car that didn't have a maker? If you answered yes for any of the above, Give details. This, the fact that it's humorous, really underscores how obvious this seems to so many people. They just think, man, Darwin is just completely crazy if he thinks that you can have design of magnificent things, you know, daisies and eagles and sharks and people without any intelligence. But that's just what Darwin is saying. It is a strange aversion of reason. But there are several others. I'm going to next introduce you to Turing's. So here's Turing's strange aversion of reason. Here's a picture of pre-Turing computers. They're wearing dresses. Before Turing, computer was a job description. What do you do for a living? I'm a computer. Computers were hired by the thousands in industry and commerce, and by the government. And they computed tables, whether they were astronomical tables with the position of the heavenly bodies for navigators, tables of all kinds. It was not very much fun work, but that was the only way to do it. And Turing realized that this didn't have to be. In the old days, computers had to understand arithmetic. Mostly these were, you know, women who had read maths and now were ready to find employment. They weren't all. We have some pictures of men who were computers too. It was equal employment opportunities for computers. You had to appreciate the reasons. This was technical work. And Turing recognized that was simply not necessary. Remember the wonderful capitalized phrase by McKenzie, in order to make a perfect and beautiful machine, it's not requisite to know how to make it. Well, let's vary that for Turing. In order to be a perfect and beautiful computing machine, it is not requisite to know what arithmetic is. That's Turing's strange inversion. And together, they, in their different ways, make the same point. Yes, there's such a thing as competence without comprehension. Now think about that, because here you are at New College of the Humanities. Why are you here? Because you believe, and your parents believe, and the state believes, everybody believes, that the way to make you competent is to help you comprehend. You're here to learn how to comprehend things so that you can then be competent in whatever you do. It makes real sense. And in general, it's true. Comprehension is, as opposed to, say, rote learning, comprehension is the key to really competent behavior in just about any sphere. Makes good pedagogical sense, but what Turing and Darwin in their different ways show is that it's not a logical necessity. And in fact, if you really want to understand what understanding is, you've got to understand that it's inverted. It's the other way around. Competence comes first. Competence without comprehension comes first in the grand scheme of design on this planet. Then you can build competences on top of competences on top of competences, and the result is going to be comprehension. That's the idea. I'm going to try to make that, if not obvious, at least palatable to you. Notice that on this view, talk about a strange inversion, mind is the effect, not the cause. It comes at the end of the causal chain, not at the beginning. It is not the source. Now, many of us think that Darwin explains the intelligent creator. In fact, explains the intelligent creator away. We can have the biosphere without intelligent design, without an intelligent creator. That's why it's such a dangerous idea. It's that inversion. People used to ask me, why did I call my book Darwin's Dangerous Idea? And I often said, well, if the people in Great Britain were to start driving on the right-hand side tomorrow, would that be dangerous? And everybody says, oh yeah, that would be really dangerous. But you know, they switched in Sweden back in 1962, around there. They switched from driving to the left to driving on the right. And they had hardly any accidents. Why? because the Swedish civil service did a brilliant job of preparing the people, and everybody did it in lockstep. One weekend, Saturday you drive on the left, Sunday you stay off the roads while they change all the signs, Monday you start driving on the right. They put it all together, had a great campaign that worked flawlessly. If the Swedish civil service could have been around to help the world appreciate Darwin in 1859, maybe we wouldn't have all this trouble. But in fact, what happened was, people realized it was sort of brilliant, but a lot of them said, well, that's all very well for your area, for your region, but not for mine. I'm a poet, as far as poetry is concerned. I'm an artist, as far as art's concerned. I'm a philosopher, as far as ethics, and legality, and literature, and all these things. As far as the humanities are concerned, we're going to do it the old-fashioned way. We're going to stay with tradition. And then you get these collision zones. And that's dangerous. That's why it's a dangerous idea, is because we haven't all moved together to this inverted view. It's strange, it's alien, but once you've done it, you know, if England switched to driving on the right, you could still go everywhere you wanted. The countryside would be as beautiful, the sights would be as wonderful, everywhere would be accessible, things would be a little bit different, and pretty much the same. And this is the inversion that I want to encourage in you. I can't resist giving you a little bit more Freeman Dyson. God is what mind becomes when it has passed beyond the scale of our comprehension. Notice, he's putting these two great ideas, God and mind, together very explicitly. Well, what do I make of this? I'll tell you, he's a great scientist. He's got a Nobel Prize, but I think he's coughing up in a bad way. This Mysterian doctrine of his, it's always available, but we should save it as a last resort when we give up on science. To see this, suppose we just change one word in the top sentence. God is what life becomes when it has passed beyond the scale of our comprehension. If you really took that seriously, you'd say, well, no, you're studying life then. No, we look, we understand. Metabolism and growth, self-repair, reproduction. We understand what life is. We want to understand what mind is, what consciousness is. And we haven't begun to exhaust the powers of science to do that. If we just say, oh, it's mysterious, let's go play tennis, then of course you won't solve the problem. That's guaranteed. Because you won't even address the problem. So I want you to realize that we can actually make real progress, but we have to base our understanding of the humanities and the mind on a solid foundation of, ultimately, biology. Can't resist giving this example. I just read this the other day. If you read the New York Review of Books, the philosopher Colin McGinn has a review of Ray Kurzweil's book, and I don't expect that Ray Kurzweil's book is any good. He's not one of my favorite thinkers. I think he makes a lot of mistakes. But I think there's a really glaring error in McGinn's review. He says, even in sober neuroscience textbooks, we are routinely told that bits of the brain process information, send signals, receive messages, as if this were as uncontroversial as electrical and chemical processes occurring in the brain. We need to scrutinize such talk with care. I agree. We need to scrutinize such talk with care. But McGinn doesn't follow his own advice. If he did, he'd have to take a couple of decades out and read cognitive neuroscience, but he doesn't want to do that. Instead, he says this. It can hardly be claimed that we have observed information transmission in the brain. This is a purely theoretical description of what is going on. I grant him that. Right, you can't see information transmission in the brain the way you can see, with the right sort of tools, electrochemical activity in the brain. And then he goes on to say, so what is the basis for the theory? And he says, the answer must surely be that the brain is causally connected to the mind, and the mind contains and processes information. In my forthcoming book, Intuition Pumps, I have a little chapter, one of the 77 chapters, is what I call the surely alarm. Here's what I say about it. I say, whenever you see a philosopher use the word surely, a little bell should ring. Ding! Surely, ding! Because you've probably just located the most weak point in the person's argument. Why? Because if it was that obvious, he wouldn't even have to say it. He doesn't want to argue for it. He's trying to nudge you along with a surely. This is almost certainly where to drive the wedge. Now, so the surely alarm. There's one of my tools. There's only 76 to go. I'm not going to give them all to you, but then you won't bother. I did a little test. I went to a website which had hundreds of papers in the philosophy line, and I simply scanned, several dozen, I think maybe about 40 or 50, for surely, the word surely, just, search, string search for surely. And I found several dozen examples of surely. And about half of them, bingo, they were the weak spot in the argument. Not all of this. Sometimes the surely can be used. But I want you, think of it this way. If you develop the habit, every time you see the word surely, just say ding, surely ding, it'll attract your attention to this, and then you can think about, wait a minute, is this the weak spot? Notice, little preview. What have I just done? I have just downloaded an app onto your neck top. Literally. It's an applet. You now have it. Part of your equipment. Your neck top now can do something and will do something without being bitten. And it's going to serve you well. That's just one of the apps. Remember I said I was going to explain to you about virtual machines and how your mind is made of virtual machines? The difference between a brain and a human mind is all the apps. And the apps come from culture. Now, in the McGinn quote, what we get is the telephone theory of information. Two intelligent understanders connected by a rather humdrum bit of wire, and the message gets passed from one to the other. And that is, in fact, the way Shannon and Weaver brilliantly isolated information in the Shannon-Weaver information theory, which you probably heard of. You may not have heard about it in those terms, but you know about it because those are bits. If you talk about how many megabytes or terabytes or gigabytes you have on some device, what you're measuring in bytes, a byte is 8 bits. A bit is a single zero or one. And it was Shannon and Weaver who developed the mathematical theory of information. And for ease, they said, we're not talking about content. We're just supposing you got two people on opposite ends of a telegraph wire or a telephone line or semaphores. It doesn't make any difference what the medium is. And one of them is sending a signal to the other, and the other is decoding. And we want to know about the channel capacity. How fast can you send bits down that stream? Bandwidth. All of these terms come from Shannon Weaver information. And that's what McGinn is apparently appealing to when he says, if we're going to talk about information in the brain, it's because the brain is attached to a mind which does the comprehending. But that's just the wrong theory of information. It's not what we want. Shannon helped himself to McGinn's understanders at both ends. But we need to take the understanders, the comprehenders, and boil them down into their proper parts. We need to understand how you can make an understander out of parts that aren't understood. In the same way that you can make a colored thing out of things that aren't colored, atoms don't have any color. In the same way you can make a living thing out of things that aren't alive, proteins aren't alive. We want to make a comprehender out of things that don't comprehend. That's the way science works. Competence without comprehension. I love this slide. What we have on the left, who knows what it is?
Termite.
In fact, this is they're called border termites from Australia. That's a termite castle. On the right, come on, humanities people. La Sagrada Familia in Barcelona. Now, they look very much alike. In fact, they look very much alike even when you take them, look inside them. I mean, these are stunningly similar artifacts made by multicellular creatures. And yet, they are also profoundly different in both design and construction. If we understand the difference between the processes that make the thing on the left and the processes that made the thing on the right, we'll have a good grip on the evolution of the humanities. This is my before and after. We've got to get from the left to the right. Termites made the one on the left. They are basically clueless. They have no idea why they do what they do. They don't have to. There's no boss termite, there's no architect termite, there's no king termite, there's a queen termite, but she looks like the crown jewel. She's not there to organize or order, she's just there to make baby termites. In other words, the termite colony has competence without comprehension. At a hand, is conveniently classic intelligent designer, the genius, charismatic, flamboyant, he's got manifestos and blueprints. He's got this all worked out in advance. This is intelligent design with a vengeance, with explanations of what his themes are and why, and he's ordering people around like that. So we have bottom-up termite construction with no boss and no clue. And we have top-down design and construction from Gaudi, where we have this godlike mind at the top, ordering everybody else around. Those are the fundamentally different processes, and we have to understand how both these processes can come into existence. And the second one is harder to understand. Here's why. Your brain is composed of about 200 billion neurons. And every one of those is a eukaryotic cell. You know, so are your blood cells and your bone cells and your hair cells. You're made of eukaryotic cells. Now, that means that every neuron in your brain is a direct descendant of free-swimming single-celled organisms, not unlike amoebas, that fended for themselves for a billion years before their descendants joined forces to make multicellular life. So you've got 200 billion termite-like things between your ears. Clueless, single-celled little agents, not so different from a bacterium or an amoeba. Actually, quite a bit different. Remember, bacterium is a prokaryote, and amoeba is a eukaryote, much smarter. Let's see what a eukaryote can do. This is an amoeba in a petri dish trying to make good connections with other neurons. It's sped up a little bit. Now this is a searching process. Something's guiding that search, some competence. It's not blind search, it's growing little processes, dendritic processes, and then it's absorbing them again and growing more. And it's trying things out and discarding them when they don't work. It's got competence without comprehension. Here's another one. Aha, find the right place? No, I don't know. So that's what your brain is made of. Neurons. They're basically clueless, but they like amoebas, they have agendas. Now here's the problem that culture solves. The question is, how do we get a Gaudi mind out of a termite colony brain? Because basically, what you got between your ears, the brain, is like a termite colony. No boss, no boss neuron, no hierarchical organization, no blueprints, and yet, somehow we build a mind, a human mind, out of that brain. You can't train a termite colony to speak, or to paint pictures, or to make science, or to have a religion, or to do any of the wonderful things that we do. But you can do that with us. So we have this huge difference in competence that we have to explain. Manifestly, it's the difference in competence that explains the McCready revolution. How do we get intelligent design of the Gaudi godlike variety, that should be small ID, with representation of reasons and so forth out of 200 billion mindless neurons? That's what I want to explain in the rest of the time of these lectures. Oh, by the way, I just saw this today. I thought I'd remind you in case you're interested. For another insect-human comparison, you might like to see tonight's documentary on the Hutterites. The Hutterites are religious sects, mainly in Canada, and their colonies, the Hutterite colonies, behave very, very much like swarms of bees, like honeybees, or like termites. They have some of the same rules of activity. I haven't seen the show. But if it doesn't go into this, it will be a travesty. Because that's one of the most interesting things about the Hutterites, is that they have reproduced a lot of features of the termite colony. That's an interesting fact. Okay. But what I want to talk about, getting to the end of my line here, is this second great endosymbiotic revolution of human culture. Here's what I want to say. In the same way that two prokaryotes came together, and one of them, as it were, got infected by another one, which then gave it more powers, that's what we've got. We're apes with infected brains. Our brains have been invaded and colonized by symbionts. And the symbionts that have come in have largely made us more competent, smarter, better, more able than we would be without those symbionts. So we want to explain how our brains get turned into our minds by seeing that they got colonized by symbionts, ideas, but a particular sort of ideas, the ideas that can spread culturally, memes. So way over here, we're the first intelligent designers on this planet. But we really are. We're getting there. We do things with foresight and with intention and with intelligence. We plan ahead. We argue about our reasons. We compare notes. No other species does that. Now, I guess I can continue.
Yeah, sure.
I'll go on a few more minutes. But any questions if you want. I'm still giving you the overview. So now, are there reasons why the termite does what it does? Yeah, there are reasons, but we don't say that the termite has the reasons. I mean, if you say that, you're sort of anthropomorphizing the termite in a way that's not really appropriate. The termite colony does things for reasons, but it doesn't have reasons. Gaudi has a reason. Now I want to introduce you to one of my favorite concepts, but also one which I think is probably ill-named by me some years ago, but I'm stuck with it. This term, free-floating rationales. When I introduced it, a lot of people had the heebie-jeebies and thought I was talking about some weird sort of ghostly presence. Not at all. There's nothing mysterious about free-floating rationales. They're just the reasons why things are the way they are that have not been represented in any mind. I'm going to try to make that very clear to you. Trees do things for reasons. They don't have minds. But they do things for reasons. Fungi do things for reasons. The biotic world is saturated with reasons, from the molecular scale on up. Everywhere you look, there's reasons why things are the way they are, why they do what they do. And those reasons are not contemplated, appreciated by any agencies at all. In fact, we do things for reasons. We shiver for reasons. We vomit. We blink. There's all sorts of sort of reflex behaviors that we engage in. Now, in one sense, we don't have a reason for doing it. You don't have a reason for sneezing. It's not an intentional action. But there is a reason why you sneeze. By the way, you may not know one of the reasons you sneeze. Among other invaders of your body are cold viruses. And cold viruses very cleverly, with no intelligence of their own, they're competent without being comprehending, they are the beneficiaries of design which makes them provoke sneezing, whereby they spread to the next host. So the sneeze doesn't necessarily do you any good. It sure does the virus some good, but that's how it gets launched to its next host. We're going to see something very similar with ideas. In fact, I'm sort of sneezing at you right now. Now, one of my favorite examples of free-floating rationales is the fledgling cuckoo. By the way, there's a brilliant, as usual, David Attenborough has an absolutely superb documentary that you can find on YouTube in a minute, in the BBC, about cuckoos. So cuckoos are brood parasites. That means they don't make their own nests. The cuckoos, very cleverly, when the cuckoo female is ready to lay her egg, she finds a bird, say like a reed warbler, and the reed warbler pair have already made their nest, got into a lot of trouble, and they laid their eggs. Now she's ready. While they go off to eat, she swoops down, lays her egg in the reed warbler's nest, and typically throws out one of the reed warbler eggs or eats it. Why? Just in case reed warblers can count. Now, does she understand that? No. She doesn't have to. She's just wired up to do this, but that's the rationale. That's the free-flowing rationale for why she eats that egg. Well, she should get a good meal, too. But mainly, it's to raise the proportion of the care for her egg. And the first thing, by the way, cuckoo chicks mature in the egg faster than the host birds do. And so they hatch first, and this is what they do. And the film, the video, I used to have some of it ran on my PC and it won't run on my Mac. These little birds, they're featherless, they're just all scrawny little fledglings, and they're doing everything they can to push all the other eggs out. And it works. And what's really weird is that the cuckoo chick is often three times as big as its adopted parents, and the adopted parents are still feeding it. Very interesting phenomenon. Why is that stable? Well, watch that documentary, you'll find out. It's a very interesting research that Nick Davis in Cambridge has done. He's the world expert on this. So you can understand the free-floating rationales in this case. And it's nice in a way, you think, we don't have to blame that murderous little cuckoo chick. It doesn't know what it's doing. It doesn't know the reason. It's killing, but it doesn't know. It's the beneficiary. I like this case, too. This is a caddis larva food suit, brilliantly designed. The water comes in the funnel at the top. It goes down through this mesh screen that the caddis larva builds, which fills that space, and it traps the food in the water. Then the caddis larva can just pick the food off the screen and eat it. So it's a device for sieving food out of moving stream water. And you notice, if you see the top view on the side there, it has a passageway. It doesn't have to go outside its castle to get to the other side of the screen. It can go back and forth to both sides of the screen. This is brilliantly engineered. Does the caddis fly understand the principles? No, it's like a termite, it's clueless. The design, there's reasons why the features are the way they are. But the caddis fly, hey, there's a caddis fly, it does not understand those reasons. Now here's a device with a very similar purpose. It's for sieving food out of water. And there's reasons for the parts here too. But the difference is, what? Well, first let's look at the similarities. There are reasons for the arrangements of the part in the lobster trap, but there's also reasons in the caddis larva's food sieve. It's just that the caddis reasons are not represented anywhere. They're only free floating. Evolution tracks these reasons, uncovers, actually honors them, but never actually uncovers them until clever human beings come along and reverse engineer these things and figure out why they are the way they are. So the first time the reasons are represented is when some biologist comes along and figures them out. But they've been doing their work all along. And this is the information made visible that McGinn doesn't see. A technique used in these studies is cross-fostering, and it exposes the concept of information we need. As you no doubt know, some birds don't need to learn their song. They're born knowing their species-specific song. If you raise a bird in isolation, it will, when it's ready to sing, it'll sing its species song. Other birds, no. They have to hear the parents sing. They learn it from their parents. They both end up with a species-specific song. Notice, they end up in the same place. They get the information from the same source, from their parents. But one time it's through the germline, through the genes. And one time it's outside through basically social learning. There are two information highways that evolution has built and optimized. The one that runs through the genes and the one that runs from parent to offspring outside the genes. Now the way you prove that there are these two is very simple, cross-fostering. You take the eggs from one species and the other and you simply reverse them, so that you create adoptive parents, again, like the cuckoo. But now the question is, what bird, what song is the bird going to sing when it hatches? Does it sing its genetic parents' song, or does it sing an adoptive parents' song? Some birds do one, some do another. Two different highways. What they have in common is the transmission of information, and this is not Shannon Weaver information, because there's no understander at either end. It doesn't have to be. That's the key. It's information, or sometimes we call it semantic information. I'm going to give you one more example of that, not drawn from biology, but drawn from human life, which nicely brings out this information. First of all, the Shannon Weaver sense of information is a measure of bandwidth and of capacity that has nothing to say about content and importance. If you want to remember that, just remember that 5 minutes of Bugs Bunny cartoon has more Shannon information in it than the Encyclopedia Britannica. It just takes more bits. So it's not valuable, not useful, but it just takes a lot of bits to specify each frame. So now, we want to talk about not Shannon Weaver information, but strategic information, semantic information. Suppose you're called in, I'll do it in America, because I can never remember which is MI5 and MI6, so forth. So the head of the CIA calls you in and says, you know, it might be actually the FBI, would you? And you know, somebody is leaking information to our enemies, and we want you to find the source. We want you to find the leak. Here's a good way of doing it. First, you get yourself some plausible but bogus information that you casually leave around in various places in the CIA or the FBI, wherever it is. And you wait to see where it shows up, you know, in Geneva or Beirut or someplace on the sort of information market. And depending on which information you put where, you say, well, this information was delivered to this department. So we know this information got from here to Beirut. Now, we don't know whether it was sent by micro dot, radio, television signal, semaphore flag, or just memorized by somebody who walked across the border, or whether it was a blueprint or whatever. We don't know the medium at all, but we have a sound proof. The information got from point A to point B. In what sense? The information at point B is sufficient to make another one of these things, whatever it is. It's the information that's worth something that people will buy because it shows how to make that nuclear trigger or that device or whatever it is. That's semantic information. It's the same notion that plays a role in police procedurals, CSI and all of that, and in spy stories, and in journalism. It's the information that's worth stealing or copying. That's this notion of information.
Okay, that.
Let's see, I got just a couple more slides. So how does culture arise? Human culture is itself one of the fruits on the tree of life. So what I want to have is a theory of cultural evolution that can unite the traditional perspectives on culture with the biological perspectives. Mother Nature is not a gene-centrist. Gene-centrist thinks that biology is all genes. Evolution says, no, it isn't. There's the genetic information highway, and then there's other information highways. Thus, the laws of physics, the gravity, they hold constant from place to place, time to time. That's in a way a kind of transmission. Long-term stabilities in the environment. The salinity of the ocean, roughly constant. Composition of the atmosphere. Colors of things. All of this can be relied on to be, you don't have to specify that in the genome because that's going to be true in the future. Well, you don't have to specify other things in the genome, thanks to social learning. I think that's a good place to stop. I will pick up on social learning the next time because that's going to lead us directly into means and how. Well, just a couple more little hints. There have been design improvements in this highway. First of all, the DNA highway is brilliantly engineered. There are many design improvements that have taken billions of years to settle in. There's proofreading enzymes, all sorts of quality control checks. It's stunning. Every year they find out more wonderful things about how wonderfully high fidelity the genetic information highway is and what makes it that way. But there have also been design improvements to the social learning highway. Prolonged infancy for prolonged parental offspring contact. That's one of the reasons, the free-floating rationales, why we have a long infancy, so that our parents can supplement what they gave us through the genes with information that they've picked up in their own lifetimes. Imprinting. Offspring zoom in on their parents. They prefer, they identify their parents and they follow them around. Makes sense. You don't want to follow somebody who's not your parent because their interests diverge from yours very rapidly. One last point, and then we'll quit on this. Gaze monitor. Human beings gaze monitor involuntarily. Do other animals gaze monitor? Almost none do. There is one exception. Dogs gaze monitor, but they don't gaze monitor other dogs. They gaze monitor human beings.
What's gaze monitoring?
Seeing where I'm looking, and then looking to see where I'm looking. You ever notice that a chimpanzee's eyes, they don't have any whites in their eyes are all brown? The whites of our eyes, it seems likely, evolved to make gaze monitoring easier. That's why if you wear sunglasses, you're the mother who wears sunglasses with her kid is really hurting her kid. Your kid needs to be able to see where mother's looking so that you can get what's known as joint attention, which is the key to learning. Mother sees that you're seeing what she sees. Look, look, it's a ducky. It's red. It's genetically transmitted, and its main purpose is to enhance the information highway that lets parents teach their offspring. And it's not found in any other species. You may have heard that chimpanzees teach their infants to crack nuts. You look at the videos and you realize, no, no, no. The mother cracks the nuts, the chimpanzee plays, gets a stick, or whatever, but the mother never intervenes to try to correct the kid. The mother never sees if, checks to see if the kid is watching. Never says, come on, you dummy, do it this way. Never, never anything like that. We're the only species that does that. And right there is one of the genetically transmitted adaptations that's going to make culture and eventually the humanities possible. More on that on Monday.